What I want to do now, I want to call up current leadership of the International African Revolution, the chairman of the African People's Socialist Party, Omali Yeshitela. I'd like to express our appreciation for everybody coming out tonight and to remind us that we are talking about a salute to the memory of Huey P. Newton, Minister of the Defense of the Black Panther Party, one of the best sons of Africa. I say that as a materialist and somebody who truly believes, as Huey P. Newton believed, that the people are the real makers of history, that it is the people who make history, not heroes, not individuals, not kings and queens, etc., but ordinary people who are in our lives simply struggling like to produce and reproduce human life, which is what human life, human society is all about in the final analysis. But even understanding that people are the real makers of history, we also understand that occasionally history will thrust forward individuals who best represent a historical period than anybody else. Maybe not before that period came about, maybe not after that period passed, but for the time, for this critical period, every now and then history will thrust forward those forces who are critical and who are significant, in whom all the elements of a period themselves are concentrated. And the way they walk and the way they talk and the things they do are earth-shaking. And sometimes they flare across the sky like a shooting star, and you can't ever forget them. Sometimes, just for that period of time, history will thrust forward forces so that we recognize Huey P. Newton as that. Somebody says what Huey P. Newton was a few weeks ago. That's not what was important about Huey P. Newton. Even the people who attempt to use who Huey P. Newton was last month did not hate him for what he was last month. They hated him for that time when he stood so tall that everybody in the world had to recognize in Huey P. Newton, there stands oppressed black people when we stand at our full stature. Shotgun in his hand, a look of determination describes Huey P. Newton. If you ever read the description of a brave man written by a coward, he will be called a fool, a lunatic, sometimes a thug and a scumbag. If you ever read the description of the victim of oppression written by the oppressor, Malcolm X once said it, they'll have you loving your enemies and hating your friends. It was said about Marcus Garvey one time that he gave us backbone where before we just had jawbone. Truly, that can be said about Huey P. Newton. Huey P. Newton was thrust forth from the wombs of history during a period, a critical period. Let's talk about it just briefly. Because somebody wants to make it a mystery, the fact that Huey P. Newton picked up the gun. But first of all, everybody in the world who was intelligent at the time had a gun in his or her hand. As the Chinese once said, there was great disorder under the heavens. There is an attempt being made to rewrite history, to put forth that era of the 60s as that time when everybody just went a little crazy, especially in Oakland, California. Maybe there was something in the water. There's no rational explanation for it. All the intelligent, wise people grew out of it, changed their minds, etc. Look on Wall Street, they show you some of the people who was important during the 60s making millions of dollars today, they say. Look in this church, they tell you, see how this person came to his senses and now preaching with nonviolence and love for everybody, etc. But the truth of the matter is that what happened in the 60s, what gave birth to the Black Panther Party, Johnny Spain and Huey P. Newton, was not peculiar to Oakland, California, or even to the U.S. The truth of the matter is, when Huey P. Newton was thrust forth in history, we lived during a period where revolution was the main trend in the entire world. In the entire world. They'll raise up Huey P. Newton in a way to try to make you hate him. You understand? They don't just do it to Huey. They dig up Martin Luther King every now and then and tell you who he was sleeping with. But you didn't follow Martin Luther King because of who he was sleeping with. And you didn't follow Huey P. Newton because he hung out in West Oakland and might have did drugs. And they know it. That's your oppressor attempting to define this reality for us. Huey P. Newton understood this reality better than anybody. I say it. Better than anybody. He understood this reality. He was a scientist. Ain't nothing wrong with science. Because I said he understood it better than anybody, I don't mean that. Nobody had differences with him in that he wasn't wrong sometime. We're not talking about whether somebody was right or wrong sometime. We're talking about whether or not they got a handle on the critical question. Yeah. On the critical question. And he had a handle on the critical question. They say Huey P. Newton taught violence because he said that political power comes from the barrel of the gun. But everybody knows political power comes from the barrel of the gun. Listen to me. Every hungry person in this country knows that what stands between them and the full shares that lucky and safe way is somebody with a gun. don't just talk about it. We do something about it. That's what he said, isn't it? And the stand that he took emboldened black and other oppressed peoples across the planet Earth, everybody. In England, I talked to people who participated in the Black Panther movement. In India, there was a Black Panther Party that still exists even up until today. When Huey P. Newton was assassinated on the streets of Oakland, we got phone calls from Sweden, from Africans, from West Africa, from England, etc. We talked to African people who are in what they call South Africa, the real name of which is Azania. When a crook steals something, always change the name, scratch the name. Oh, used to be South Africa, used to be Azania. They come in, steal it, scratch the name off, write South Africa, call themselves South Africa, act like they always been there. Used to be Turtle Island. Europeans leave Europe, come here, kill most of the inhabitants of the land, take the land from it, scratch the name off, call it America, call themselves Americans, act like they always been here. Bring you over, scratch the name off. Call you Americans. Negro Americans. Afro Americans. African Americans. Americans after a while. Americans one day in the near future. Act like you always been here. But Huey P. Newton was a scientist. And we have to grapple with the science that Huey grappled with. I want to pass it because otherwise we get stuck with bourgeois vulgar opinions. I had an uncle who was the toughest guy in St. Petersburg, Florida. He wasn't a revolutionary, but he had enough science to be able to say that, Slim, that's what he called. He said, conversation is the cheapest commodity on the block. Everybody's got one. Right? So we're not talking about vulgar opinions, like everybody has got an opinion. We're talking about science. And when we talk about science, we're talking about, therefore, something which can be backed up by something real in the world. Because there are forces who would have you believe what your eyes tell you to be otherwise, what your ears tell you to be otherwise. They'll say, America, when will America be America again? And you're supposed to say, yeah, when will America again? You mean we got to do this one more time? You know what I'm saying? They will say silliness to you like that. They will try to bomb you with nonsense and a certain kind of humanism. You know, we're all in the same boat. We're all together, all the same boat. Hell, we were in the same boat when we came here. Except I was down there tied down and you was up there being the captain. So it ain't a matter of all being in the same boat. Even as we recognize the universality of our existence and being here on the planet Earth, recognize those lines, draw those lines that can tell us why particular things happen to us as a people that distinguish from what's happening to anybody else. You gotta know that, don't you? You must know that. If somebody asks you, people don't just walk around saying they want fruit, they want grapes. And they want oranges. You've got to be able to make distinction even when you talk about fruit. And even as we talk about all the peoples on the planet and all the peoples inside this country, we got to be able to determine with all these people, why is it that certain kinds of things happen to us? If we don't do that, we're in big time trouble. But Huey P. Newton didn't do that. That's one of the reasons he received the wrath of the system. I want to just share something that he said that made me love him, and I think made him loved by masses of people around the world. You know, it wasn't just black people love Huey P. Newton, right? He told you that when he said, when I was in China, I was talking to the Vietnamese. So the Vietnamese didn't think there was nothing wrong with Huey P. Newton loving black people. Otherwise, the Vietnamese would be in trouble, wouldn't they? Yeah. You notice that during the Vietnamese Revolution, everybody tell them that y'all shouldn't be fighting against American imperialists, and y'all should try to integrate instead. They don't say that till it's us. Nobody told the Cubans, look, stop fighting, saying we shall overcome and integrate with your oppressors. Cubans existed as a national entity, and the Vietnamese as a national people fighting for national independence. We've been put in a trick bag. Somebody took away our national self-determination and then said that they ain't doing doing it because you, they didn't take away your freedom. They defined you as some kind of race. But the problem we suffer from is not because white people are white and we are black and Mexicans and other people look different from us. The problem we suffer from is because somebody established themselves and their own freedom at the expense of ourselves and our freedom. You have a nation that rests upon the oppression of another nation. That's what we are talking about. See? So you don't get hung up with we can love anybody, can we? Although in the 60s, there was a time, because we had to really make a struggle in the 60s, there was a time during the civil rights movement where it was necessary because a certain sector of our population that was trying to keep us from identifying our enemy and fighting for our oppression and fighting against our oppression, trying to keep us turning the other cheek and groveling on our bellies. This is before the advent of Huey P. Newton. There was a certain sector that told us we were not supposed to fight back. We were just supposed to lay on our bellies and die. Somehow Malcolm used to characterize it as, what did he call it? He said, overwhelm them with your capacity for love, right? But in the civil rights movement itself, this is the part of the movement that gave birth to the Black Panther Party and to Huey P. Newton. There used to be a song based on a popular song at the time called Too Much Love. And the song went like, too much love, nothing kills a nigga like too much love. because the truth of the matter is that the time has come to stand up. And even in the process of loving, because I've got to love me long enough to live. And I've got to love you seriously enough to do for you what I've always done for my oppressors. Because nobody ever said we was too violent when we were fighting in Korea for them. Or when we were fighting in Vietnam for them. We just got violent at that juncture when we began to identify what our own interests are and were capable of fighting for that. Huey P. Newton and the Black Panther Party, you know the history of it. In our movement, that is what was called the Civil Rights Movement, a great debate began to rage around the question of self-defense. Should we just continue to do, as Malcolm X say, meet police dogs, the most vicious kind of attacks on our people, talking about overwhelming them with our capacity to love? Or should we act like all the other intelligent human beings on the planet Earth and defend ourselves? That was a question the whole civil rights movement was involved in. Now, it was not just some abstract ideological question. It was a question that had practical material implications. What were they? In the first place, our movement, our civil rights movement, was something that was given birth by material conditions in the world. It was the fact that the United States, US imperialism, had become the most powerful country on the planet Earth at that time as a consequence of the Second Imperialist War, the second war to redivide the world. Whereas before, Europe controlled most of the resources of Africa, Asia, and Latin America as colonies, black people, brown people, yellow people, as colonies. Now, with the Second Imperialist War, that was a war to redivide the world. I don't care what nobody tells you about fighting for democracy against Hitler and the rest of it, because even as they was fighting against Hitler, they was lynching black people in this country. I don't want anybody ever tell me anything about Nazism, fascism, and Hitler, etc. Talk to me about Thomas Jefferson. Talk to me about George Wallace. Talk to me about Robert Kennedy. Talk to me about American imperialism. There's no imperialism ever on the planet Earth being worse than U.S. imperialism. There's no oppression ever existed worse than the oppression that African people have suffered right here in this country. Don't tell me about Hitler and 6 million people dying. They kill 100 million black people just from Africa to here. So this country, this system, a system born of killing Indians and enslaving people, has no redeeming value. It's like what the Supreme Court that Brother Spain was talking about just said that pornography was. It has no socially redeeming value. Check it out. It is a system which built institutions, like Huey P. Newton was talking about. Built institutions. Institutions sprang from them. Law, the rest of it, that validated its own existence. So that slavery was legal, getting away from slavery was illegal. Killing
And if you could make the law definitely, slavery wouldn't be legal. So we got all these institutions built upon our oppression. That's what we have to understand. In the first place, that's what we have to understand. So we have a whole system, and during the Second Imperialist War, this country became filthy rich, but it had a problem with where it was going to get workers to transform the raw materials that were being brought from Africa, Asia, and Latin America. They used to get them from East Europe, but at that time, Eastern Europe was considered a part of the Soviet bloc after the war, so they couldn't do it. So they got them from down south. This was like the third great migration of African people in this country. This is when most of your parents came from Louisiana and Texas and the rest of it to California. This is when we moved from Mississippi into Chicago and other places, and from Georgia up into New York and the rest of it, getting away from down there to factories that was open up. This was the basis of the momentum around civil rights and this kind of thing. First of all, so that we could have the mobility to leave a plantation in the South to go to a plantation in the North. This was the basis for the impetus that saw civil rights, white politician, Northern politician, because this is the basis of liberalism. White liberalism was based on the need of a certain sector of the white ruling class in the North, where they needed us as workers, as opposed to that sector of the white ruling class in the South, where they needed us digging ditches and picking cotton and the rest of that. So here's the basis for a struggle. I'm talking about a material basis for it. And so the basis, we saw meeting together the interests of the liberal sector of the white ruling class and the interests of what we call the black petty bourgeoisie or the black middle class. The black middle class also had its own aspirations. First of all, it hated itself. First of all, it is alienated from itself. It hates being black. It hates it more than anything. It would rather be with white people and like white people more than anything on the planet. So it's filled with self-hatred. That's why every time it gets a chance, it gets the first thing leaving the black community. It gets the first thing getting out of here because it's filled with self-hatred. In the second place, we're talking about having interest in becoming themselves. What W.E.B. Du Bois had was defined as a talented tenth, as that sector of the black community that could represent white power inside our own community. They knew that for them to get elected, you had to be able to vote. You don't believe, you think I'm making it up. You say, well, no, they were really nice people. They may have been. May have loved their mothers and the whole bit. But the truth of the matter is, if you look at the world today, you see almost 10,000 black elected officials in this country, and you see black people in worse condition than we've ever been in our existence. You don't hear one of them saying a single thing about the oppression of black people. They don't even say black people. They're talking about the haves and the have-nots. They're talking about the left down, bottom, and the vote at the bottom got to rise, and this kind of stuff. But they don't say nothing about black people are suffering. Black people are suffering. So here, you have this black petty bourgeoisie wedded with the liberal sector of the white ruling class that funded the civil rights movement. I say that as somebody who participated in the civil rights movement. I say that as somebody who registered black voters throughout the South at the risk of life. So I'm even in the process of doing it, I'm critiquing my own activity. And I'm talking about we were a part of a movement that was funded by the liberal sector of the white ruling class, and that is why that movement had to have, as a philosophy, non-violence, not as a tactic. Didn't say, listen, you know, we're outnumbered, we're surrounded at different times, you can't just walk on a demonstration picking up a gun. Philosophically, it said non-violence was out of the question because it was funded by the liberal sector of the ruling class, and the liberal sector of the no sector of the ruling class is about to give you some money that you might buy a Uzi with and hide out in Acorn or any other project inside this country. So this debate was raising up inside the black liberation movement itself. The thing was so serious that before you could even go on a demonstration with these guys, they would give you lessons in being beaten up. They would give you lessons, you know, like you didn't have enough practice, right? They would say that this, and they would beat you up to make sure how you would react before you got to the demonstration. That was a whole great just struggle happening inside our movement about this question, non-philosophical non-violence. And then there was Malcolm X, who was critiquing and criticizing all of this stuff. And then we look at Malcolm, we see the impact on Huey P. Newton, the impact on all of us around this particular question. And then you see Huey P. Newton, who, as he said, said we are practical revolutionaries. We'll end the debate. We'll show you how to where the debate is. And they put on blue turtleneck shirts, black leather jackets, a parade, a bandolier, and picked up a shotgun. Discussion ended. Here it is. And it excited the imagination of African people throughout the world. It was a question put forth by history, not Huey. Huey didn't make up the debate. He wasn't in the march in Mississippi in 1966, where the debate broke out with the demand for black power. He didn't make up that discussion. The movement, history itself, demanded that we address the question of whether or not we'll be continuing to grovel at the feet of our oppressors for the rest of our existence, which surely won't be long, or whether we shall stand up like real men and women and take responsibility for our lives and the history that we have to make. It wasn't just important for us. It was important for all the other people who were dying at the hand of U.S. imperialism as well. And as a consequence of the action that Huey P. Newton still took, it was necessary for U.S. imperialism to retreat out of Vietnam. Yes, it was necessary for U.S. imperialism to retreat out of Vietnam. How do I know? I know it not only because of the practice of what was happening inside this country. I know it not only because the U.S. had to fight their way out of Detroit. And because the Vietnamese told us that they learned the lessons that they put down in the Tet Offensive from the Black Revolution, then half the Black Rebellion in Detroit. I also learned it because the other peoples around the world look for the Black Liberation Movement in unity. We live in a period today where oppressed peoples have to try to make a deal with U.S. imperialism, have to try to make a deal, but during the time of the 60s when we stood tall, then Che Guevara could call for 2-3 mini Vietnams, and black people in Oakland and throughout this country stood up and tried to accommodate him. We made him come out of Vietnam. Huey P. Newton, writing about the history, this is in June 1967, the month after the comrades went into Sacramento with the guns, remember that? The state capitol. Where they were debating again, there's another debate. Where they were debating the question of whether they were going to take guns away from black people, just like they debated in 1989. And 40 Panthers walked into right into the middle of the debate in Sacramento, the state legislature. Debate over. Black history is on the scene. Black people standing up. And being able to stand up because the stances brother took. Now you know yourself how hard it is to take that kind of stand. You know it every time the police say something to you and you bite your tongue because you don't want to say nothing back because you don't want to go to jail. You know it every time you're in a store and some rotten, filthy clerk messes over you just because you didn't look right or didn't say the right word. You know you can't even have a decent argument with them as a man or a woman because you know the first thing they're going to do is dial 911 and the police going to escort you out with knots upside your head. You know what I'm saying? You know that. You know what it is to live in America. You know you're scared to open your mouth because you end up spending the rest of your life in a chain gang for nothing. But Huey P. Newton stood up. He stood up. He didn't just stand up. On a day, one day in October, right over there in West Oakland where they assassinated him, Huey P. Newton took a stand. He stood up and they fell down. When we stand up, they fall down because that's the nature of this system. They stand on our back. When we stand up, they fall down. Huey P. Newton stood up. Officer Freight fell down, went down. Now, Officer Freight might have been a nice guy. You understand what I'm saying? He might have loved his mother. His wife might have wore white when he got married. He might even help little old ladies in the white community across the street. But it ain't nothing personal off on Officer Frey, just like when he stopped Huey in that car, it wasn't nothing personal. He just do it to all the black people. You understand what I'm saying? That's the nature of the system. The system is against black people. They don't care which one until you become so significant that the rest of us look up to you. But ordinarily, like they have a thing in this system, right here in this city, they call it some kind of proactive policing. Well, the thing is, according to what black policemen have said, their intent is to stop every black man in the city of Oakland. Chaplin and identify him and put him on the record. So they don't care who you are, they just want all of you. That's the way the state functions. It's has to do not even with Frey as a nice person. I'm sure he was nice. But Huey was writing in June of 1967. I'm sure you can find a lot of people. Every time you know a policeman died, a lot of people think he's nice. They come out, you know, hundreds of them, sometimes thousands, and have parades and salute and stuff. They don't do it like that, you know, but they salute, and everybody say he was a nice guy. So I believe that there's, from a certain viewpoint, even a policeman is nice. It's not personal. My daughter once talked to me about being a policeman. I said, that's cool, but you understand what side you're on once you do it. I'm with everybody else. He was writing about how this country was founded. It ain't personal, is it? That's what science is about. So if you don't get bogged down in emotionalism and whether it's personal or not like that. Just because you like a funeral home director don't mean that you're going to die a couple of years early so you can get the body. Understand? Ain't personal. Your best friend might be a funeral director. You understand what I'm saying? You might go with a slum lord, but you don't raise your own rent just because you go with them. You got interest, they got interest. You understand? Ain't nothing personal in it. You know what I'm saying? Thank personal. So Huey was writing, he said, talking about how white people came here as an extended part of a colony from Europe. He said, now these same colonized white people, these ex-slaves, robbers and thieves, have denied the colonized black man the right to even speak of abolishing this oppressive system which the white colonized American created. They have carried their madness to the four corners of the earth, and now there is universal rebellion against their continued rule and power. He didn't say there was a rebellion in Oakland or on East 14th. He said universal rebellion against their continued rule and power. The black people in America, he said, are the only people who can free the world. Loosen the yoke of colonialism and destroy the war machine. As long as the wheels of the imperialist war machine are turning, there's no country that can defeat this monster of the West. But black people can make a malfunction of this machine from within. Black people can destroy the machinery that's enslaving the world. See, he didn't say violence for the sake of violence or rent. He said, we can destroy the machine that's enslaving the world. Unselfish, totally unselfish. America cannot stand to fight every black country in the world and fight a civil war at the same time. It is militarily impossible to do both of these things at once. The slavery of blacks in this country provides the oil for the machinery of war that America used to enslave the peoples of the world. Without this oil, the machinery cannot function. We are the driving shaft. We are in such a strategic position in this machinery that once we become dislocated, the functioning of the remainder of the machinery breaks down. Pinned up in the ghettos of America, surrounded by his factories, and all the physical components of his economic system, we have been made into the wretched of the earth, who are relegated to the position of spectators, while the white races run their international con game on the suffering peoples. We have been brainwashed to believe that we are powerless, and that there is nothing we can do for ourselves to bring about a speedy liberation for our people. We have been taught that we must please our oppressors, that we are only 10% of the population, and therefore we must confine our tactics to categories calculated not to disturb the peace of our tormentors. The power structure inflicts pain and brutality upon the peoples and then provides controlled outlets for the pain in ways least likely to upset them or interfere with the process of exploitation. The people must repudiate the channels established as tricks and deceitful snares by the exploiting oppressors. The people must oppose everything the oppressor supports and support everything that he opposes. If black people go about their struggle for liberation in the way that the oppressor dictates and sponsors, then we will have degenerated to the level of groveling flunkies for the oppressor himself. When the oppressor makes a vicious attack against freedom fighters because of the way that such freedom fighters choose to go about their liberation, then we know we are moving in the direction of our liberation. The racist dog oppressors have no rights which oppressed black people are bound to respect. As long as the racist dogs pollute the earth with the evil of their actions, they do not deserve any respect at all. And the rules of their game, written in the people's blood, are beneath contempt. Huey P. Newton. That's the basis. That's why Huey is dead. I hope you know that. Now I'm going to say one other thing, and I'm going to get out of your way. That has to do with this question of who killed Huey P. Newton. Did the government kill Huey P. Newton? The government murdered Huey P. Newton. I want to say one other thing in relationship to that. The first thing I want to say is that I don't know any place on the planet Earth, no place on the planet Earth, where African children are not abused children, where African people were not abused people. We live in a country where in the capital, the so-called national capital, Washington, D.C., the infant mortality rate is equal to that of Guatemala. We live in a county right here where the infant mortality rate of black children is four times higher than white children in Piedmont. Understand? I mean, to be an African in this world is to be abused. You can convince our community that at this time that we began to see heroin penetrate the black community for the first time. All over the country, heroin everywhere. Sullivan, controlling the counterintelligence program designed to destroy the black liberation movement from in here, leaves to set up to initiate the so-called war against drugs in Southeast Asia, and is responsible for heroin being brought into this country to use against black people. That's in the 1970s. By 1972, 73, for all practical purposes, the black liberation movement has been crushed. So it's not necessary to concentrate the war on single individuals and single organizations so much as it is to keep down this powerful, oppressed, mass of African people. The whole people now become the target. So as this country now goes into Latin America, where the war is now being concentrated against the people of Nicaragua and El Salvador and the rest of it, suddenly we see African people in this country decide that we're not going to do heroin anymore. We're going to do what has previously been a white man's drug and an upper class white man at that. Cocaine. We see flooding from cocaine from places in Bolivia, Colombia, and the rest where puppet governments have been set up by U.S. imperialism. Control. You can track this down. The Kerry Commission, which is a commission of the U.S. Congress, has documented that these Contras, these reactionary people who serve U.S. imperialism against their own people, have been trading guns for drugs. They have said that drugs were picked up at the ranch of a man named John C. Hull, who's a CIA agent in Costa Rica. Drugs have been picked up and brought by airplane to Homestead Air Force Base in Florida. What happened to them? But you and I are to believe that somehow black youth in the projects are bringing drugs into this country. You and I have to believe that you're fighting the war against drugs when you tell the police to go kill kids in the projects. They tell us that the drug trade may be worth $300 billion a year. And you and I are supposed to believe that $300 billion a year is coming to the projects in the black communities of this country. It's an insanity. Right. projects. Disarm them. Disorganize them, because that's who Huey P. Newton organized. He organized those young brothers and sisters right out here. I just want to say this. When you talk about the drugs in our community, you're not talking about a drug problem. You're talking about a drug economy that's been imposed on the community. The same white ruling class that won't let black people work in the legal capitalist economy has created an illegal capitalist economy in our communities. The truth of the matter is, sisters and brothers, and we know it, that if there was no drug money in the community, there wouldn't be no money in the community. Wait a minute. I'm not looking for applause. I'm saying this, that the dope money pays the slumlord his rent. The dope money pays PG&E its money. The dope money pays MUR. The dope money pays the politicians, the pigs, and the rest of it. The dope money goes into the real estate industry. That's why the rent gets higher and higher, and the cost of housing higher and higher. Black kids in the community ain't got nothing to do with that. The money's being laundered by the banks that's associated with Lionel Wilson and his funky son. And yet, they're attacking my kids in the projects. I didn't make it up. They put it in the newspaper, said Lionel Sons a dope pusher. Said that they called up, FBI called up Lionel and said, Lionel, we're gonna raise your son. When they got there, the house was clean, but $250,000 that happened to be in the trunk of the car parked in the driveway. Owned by his girlfriend. But he didn't have nothing to do with it. Don't know where the money come from. That every day somebody drop off $250,000. That's clear. Understand? And you and I are supposed to act like we go along with this nonsense. Let me tell you what's happening. Why do they bring the drugs in? A number of reasons. One, money. It's a lot of money. It's a lot of money. Them kids functioning in the drug trade are penny ante dealers. You understand? They are penny. They own. They wear everything they own on their neck, on their fingers, and the car they drive. And they don't keep that but for 2 or 3 months until they accumulate enough, then the state take it from them. You understand? Don't even make no difference how many people they arrest, the dope stay there. They say, we can't find it. Hell, you could find it if you put it the same place you put the jobs. You know what I'm saying? You could find it. You could find Gaddafi's baby from 37,000 feet up in the air at 5 o'clock in the morning to bomb him out of existence. If you could find Gaddafi's baby in Libya, you could find the dope coming through the Court of Oakland. So I want to be clear. So that's one reason. The money, a lot of money. Talking about a country with a serious budget deficit and a whole capitalist system that's falling apart. I don't care what Gorbachev said, this system is rotten to its seams. You understand? One. Two, they need it as a political justification to make war against our people and our community. And especially with these old Uncle Toms who run around to my bring some more police. Because they're punks and cowards. And Huey P. Newton told us not to be punks and cowards. He said, if you got a problem in the community, do something about it. Don't call the oppressor to solve the problem. When in the hell does the police solve the problem for black people? You call the police, say, my son acting crazy, I don't know what to do with the police, come out and kill him. Say, now you know what to do with the bury. You call the police, say, my television was stolen. You never get your television back, and you're lucky if they don't whoop your ass, and you know it. Right. That's the police. When is it you ever heard of a police solving a problem, truthfully? I'm not just here saying it. If you know they solve a problem, then keep calling. I'm talking Africans. I'm talking black people in here. Because they do solve some problems for white people. Sometimes you go in their community, 911, problem solved. But generally speaking, for Africans, that's the truth. Crime watch everywhere. You know what I'm saying? Yeah, you know. So, but they don't solve no problems. They represent the oppressor. So what it means is that we got to solve our own problems. That brother was right when he said ideology is key. You don't even know who you are. You don't even know who you are. That's why Huey P. Newton put down point number 5 of the Black Panther Party 10-point program. Somebody tell me what it was. Has to do with education. It teaches us the true nature of this system and who we are. Right? That's what it was about. That's what the key question was about. So that you can know who you are. If you know who you are, you know who your friends are, who your enemies are. Know what to do about it. So, to make war against our community, to destabilize the community, to keep it constantly involved in struggling against itself, self-inflicted wounds all the time against ourselves, going down in the community, all the time. Sometimes you don't know where it's coming from. Sometimes it's a drive-by shooting. We don't know who did it. I know who did it. See, but the police wouldn't do nothing like that. Hell, they did slavery. If they did slavery, they can't do nothing worse than slavery. What can they do worse than slavery? Anything is an improvement over the way they got us here. That's what I'm talking about, because the system is capable of committing crimes that bothers your mind. So you know you could never do something like that. You just can't believe it. You just refuse to believe they wouldn't do that to us. They did it to you. They did it to you. They do it all the time. They teach you to define violence according to their terms. Huey was violent because he picked up a gun. They destroyed Hiroshima, Nagasaki. You never hear anybody say America's violent. So they destabilize our community, they destroy the will of the people, the struggle. You can't think about fighting you every 15 minutes you got a problem. Every 15 minutes you gotta get another hit. Every 15 minutes. You can't think long term if you gotta solve a problem every 15 minutes. Every 15 minutes problem. Every 15 minutes another hit. How are you gonna think about the future? You can't even think about tomorrow, whether or not your child is gonna go to school. How are you gonna think about the future? Now let me tell you something. My criticism, my fundamental criticism of this system. My second criticism is of those who know and will not move. Those who know and will not organize. Those who know but simply cry and complain and won't do what has to be done. Those who shirk our responsibility to be men and women and stand up for ourselves. That's my second criticism. I tell you who I don't criticize. I don't criticize the victims. I don't criticize those bloods out in the projects doing the best they can. Because they lost their leadership. When they destroyed the Black Panther Party, they destroyed the leadership. All the people have leadership. White people have leadership all the time. You understand? Might be reactionary leadership, but if you ain't got no leadership, you see, the community, all societies follows the leadership of the advanced sector. Well, we had a leadership out there, the people organized, patrolled the communities, protected the communities, put together a sickle cell anemia testing program under Huey P. Newton, put together free breakfast for school children programs under Huey P. Newton, did all of these kinds of things that taught us to stand up. That's when we had an advanced force out in the community to kill the advanced force, and then the communities open up to anything they want to do. The people are the victims. The kids in the projects are the victims. But our enemies know their potential, just like Huey knew their potential. Our enemy knows their potential, partially because of the fact that Huey existed. So, they act like black people with guns have just suddenly become a problem. Those kids and their projects with guns. But I remember another time when black people with guns were a problem, even when they stood up against the drugs in the community. All you got to do is be black. Have a gun and have the potential of organizing your people for liberation, and you're a problem. Those youth out there, the problem is not that they got a gun. The problem is that they don't have ideology. I say 2, 3, many guns, but our responsibility is to give them ideology. Sisters and brothers, our oppressors give with one hand, take back with the other hand. They gave the black petty bourgeoisie what they thought, affirmative action. One hand, take it back with the other hand. They gave them what they thought would be set aside for the colored, you know, the Negroes get in the office and stuff and pass off this business to their buddies and stuff like that. They gave it to them, they bought them off. Gave it to them with one hand, take it back with the other hand. They are creating misery for the masses of our people all over this country and in Oakland itself. The reason, the conditions that gave birth to the existence of Huey P. Newton continue to be here right now. The deed to struggle continues right now. We struggle in the tradition of the Black Panther Party. And by that, let me tell you what it means. Let me be right up front, right up clear to you. Because a lot of people don't like the Uhuru movement, and that's cool too. And I'm going to say why we think they don't like us and what. We believe that this system has no redeeming value. Huey said, the oppressor forced something, we're against it. We'll check out the details later. If they want it, we're opposed to it. Right up front, the system born off our bread, right up front. They say they want to do it, I'm opposed. Check out the dividends. say, check out the details. We know something wrong with it, right? Check out the details, find out what it is, but if they for it, I'm against it. That's the Uhuru movement. That's the African People's Socialist Party, right? We believe that the liberation of our people in concert with the liberation of the vast majority of people on the planet, because most of the people on the planet live in abject misery. The few exceptions being Japan, imperialist Japan, imperialist Europe, and imperialist North American communities inside this country. Most of the people on the planet live in abject misery, ignorance, dying from curable diseases and the rest of it. We don't believe that this system can be reformed. We didn't pray our way in here. We don't believe we're gonna be able to pray our way out of here. We didn't sing our way in here. We don't believe we're gonna be able to sing our way out of here. You understand? Now that's no radical statement. That means that we think we're just like everybody else. Everybody else who wanted freedom had to fight for it. They had to shed their blood to get it. They had to shed somebody else's blood to get it. So we understand that. That's no call to war. We aren't asking anybody to go out and do anything yet. Because generally what happens is people know when it has to be done. We believe that it's absolutely necessary for our people to wage a struggle for national liberation. We are a people. And we have to fight for our freedom as a people. But the boundaries of our struggles are bigger than North America. We are one people. If we got on the boat in Africa in 1619 as African people, when we got off the boat in Jamestown, Virginia, we were still African people. You can't get on no boat in Africa as one thing and then get off in America as something else. We were African then, we are African now. We are one people. I know that's a struggle, as particularly from Africans from my generation. But just because you don't know you're an African, don't mean you ain't no African. It just means you're a dumb African. That's all. If you don't believe you're an African, help Michael Jackson find his lips, because them was African lips that he cut off. You know what? He's regretted it ever since. Because you can't kiss good if you don't have African lips. But the point is, we are one people. They teach us that we are minority. Everybody, we're talking about a minority. White people are minority on the planet. But they teach us we are minority. And you will be a minority if you only see your church is Westover, right, or Eastover, right, or Oakland, right, or North America. But if you understand that African people, sisters and brothers, suffering from the same problem and the same cause, are in Kenya, are in Nigeria, Liberia, are in Jamaica, Trinidad, are in Brazil, are in Canada, are in London, all over the world, African people struggling for their identity and struggling for their freedom. And once we identify our identity, come to terms with who we are, there will be nothing on the planet Earth that will be able to stand between us and our freedom. Sisters and brothers, Huey P. Newton was a giant who walked among us. He suffered because his movement was crushed down around him. He said, as long as the people have been here, I've been able to be free. I've been able to be alive. I thought that I wouldn't make 25. Then I thought that I wouldn't be able to get out of prison, but the power of the people is something else. When the people needed Huey to galvanize us into motion, he was there. But he needed the people too. When they defeated our revolution, him, Johnny Spain, and others were trapped in circumstances beyond their control, couldn't do too much about it. Johnny Spain, there were people reaching out, gave him sustenance, etc. Huey P. Newton, he was the lightning rod. He was the one that was on the cutting edge all the time. He drew all the heat. He never lived alone since 1967. There was always somebody on his phone who wasn't supposed to be there. There was always somebody listening in his bedroom who wasn't supposed to be there. There was always somebody following him. In fact, the police know who killed him because they were with him on the night, on the morning that he died. Did the police or the government kill Huey P. Newton? They killed him just as surely as slavery existed. They killed him just as surely as they brought the first load of heroin in here from Southeast Asia. teachers to poison our people and to initiate chemical warfare. They kill them just as surely as they're maiming people right now in Nicaragua and in South America, where they're bringing the cocoa leaf in that they make cocaine from. They killed them just as surely as somebody walked up into them. Maybe they didn't have the badge on. Maybe they were undercover and put poo bullets into his brains. Sisters and brothers, the police department arrested somebody. Somebody. They even had cameras who took the pictures of them being arrested. And they said, we didn't arrest nobody for Huey P. Newton's death. It might have been, sisters and brothers, that they arrested their own people accidentally and had to turn them loose. I know this. For 20 years, they wanted to kill Huey P. Newton, and Huey P. Newton is now dead. This government has a track record for killing the people that he wants dead. All power to the people.
No!